You're listening to Amped Radio.
Amped Radio.
Internet radio that will blow your frickin' mind.
Thank you for visiting the Bolin Alley, the home of Bolin Services. We're the star makers and risk takers, but don't f*** with us or we'll break you. Don't believe us? Just ask the Iron Sheik and John Cena Sr. We'll now take you to your entertainment for tonight. The star maker Kenny the King Bolin and Chris the Prince Bolin.
Here we go.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's about damn time we're back. I've got Kenny, the King, the Star Maker, Bolin. And we got Chris. He's actually remote, and he's calling in. He is the Prince.
I am roving today.
Where are you at, Prince? You down in Florida recruiting talent? Where are you?
There's no talent to be recruited in Florida. I think we're all well aware of that. That place is bone dry and bare, and I'm going to keep my location a secret for the night.
I think I heard there is no talent in Tampa. I did hear that. I heard that recently.
From what I've seen at TNA, Orlando doesn't have much hope either.
Drying up like sap down there.
I've never seen such a fucking pitiful roster that TNA's promoting right now. They're burying Samoa Joe, the man that pretty much saved wrestling back in 02, 03, 04. They fucking killed him. What's the fucking use?
I've watched two TNA shows in the last 9 months.
Yeah, I guarantee you, Joe did jobs on both.
Joe did jobs on both. Flair bled on both. Jeff Jarrett had that thing he calls a wife on both, the thing that Angle used to call a wife. And he was trying to convince everybody he was an MMA star.
Well, he is a bad, bad man with a guitar, so I guess, you know, country music, fucking Kimura, same thing, really, I guess.
I don't know if you've missed us, ladies and gentlemen, not to interrupt you there, Prince, wherever you are in your hidden secret location tonight. Double remote secret from what I hear. Not even I know. But we've been off for a while, and we've made a decision here at the Alley. We've come into an awful lot of money since the press has been kicking ass on OVW television, and cash has been rolling in. I can't count all the goddamn money that's coming in lately. So Rob Dickin has persuaded me to make at least the original airings of the Bolin Alley the way they used to be on Who's Slamming Who, and that's free of charge. Basically, he says, because there's so many of you tight sumbitches out there that won't cough up a dollar to save your own goddamn lives, more or less listen to me in the cat box trying to improve your lives. The Prince. So what we're going to do is we're going to make these things free. And then if you want to order the seasons at the end of the year, then you're welcome to do that. Knows you'll have to pay for, you tightwad bastards. And we'd like to thank those of you that did buy. But I can't count all the goddamn money that's coming in anyway, so shit, we'll just give it for free. And that'll give me less money to count and make my life a lot less stressful. How about you, Prince?
It sounds fine to me. So, Rob, do you have any topics for us this week?
I've got a few. I know that... The King wanted to actually catch Raw on Monday to really comment on it. I personally haven't watched the last two, but I have been keeping up with the CM Punk.
As a matter of fact, before Prince hit the road last night to head off to whatever town it was he was heading to, I insisted that he come by and see the Punk Triple H John Cena promo to open the show, and I was very pleased with most of what I saw.
I was too at the time that I watched it, but looking back, it seems as though they've PG'd Punk. That wasn't the Punk that we had a month ago that was cutting these, you know, as he called it, a pipe bomb promo.
Well, they told him, though, he was... They toned him down a little bit, I'll give you that.
What made him a babyface in that initial promo was that he wasn't being a babyface. He was being, you know, legit. He was cutting a promo that he believed in.
Right, he was being punk.
Yes, but this was a very babyface promo. Huh?
He was being what you and I both know him to be.
Yes, exactly, and I respected that, and I think a lot of people respected that. But the promo that he cut Monday was very babyface for the crowd, I'm doing it for you bullshit.
Yeah,
and I hated that. It fucking took away from it.
I agree with that. I've watched that promo two or three times now, and I would agree that there was a lot of fan ball licking going on there.
You know, I know that Punk didn't put that in there, but they see him as a potential new John Cena, and I think they want to capitalize on that. Not realize that what we gave them Steve Austin was the heel that people liked. I mean, Steve Austin was redeeming things the first 2 years of the babyface run. He was just the heel that everybody loved.
And never gave a shit if anybody liked him or not. As a matter of fact, it pissed him off if you did like him.
Exactly, and that's what I think they're missing the boat on here with Punk. They have a very good chance at an anti-hero character like Austin, and they're fucking shitting on it for t-shirt sales.
Yeah.
And I think in the long run, that's going to bite them in the ass. It's going to cost Punk a lot of fans and really shorten his top run.
Well, I was hoping that shirt that he had there was, because I didn't recall seeing any WWE logos on it. You claim you did.
At the bottom of it, yeah, WWE, because the ones that they had for that pay-per-view that I guess Punk had made up, they had WWE shit.
Right.
They're for like $500 and $600 on eBay right now with the Dayton.
That kills the whole fucking thing is him wearing a shirt with a WWE logo on it.
Exactly.
Kills the whole fucking thing.
I mean, he's not really an anti-WWE guy, but he's not really pro-company. It's not like NWO or Black New Japan where they're trying to bring down the company, but he's not a company man, and that's what puts him over, but...
Dick, and here's what I had said last night and the Prince. We don't often always perfectly agree on how we think an angle should go, but we pretty much were in line with this one. And what I wanted to have happen, and I told everybody this before the show even started, is that John Cena comes out, cuts his promos to why he should be champ. Punk comes out, tells his story. Here comes Triple H. We know he's going to come eventually. And we know that Punk and Triple H, he's called him a doofus. So we already know that Punk does not like Triple H, regardless whether he's signed or not. And then Triple H would say, yes, Cena, you got a legit claim to this title. You won you beat the guy that won the tournament. You got a legit claim to the title. Punk, you were the champion. Key word is were. You won the pay-per-view, Money in the Bank. You won the title. But guess what, pal? An hour and 12 minutes later, your contract expired, which means you were no longer with the company, which means you forfeit reign to your WWE title. That is a WWE world title you have. And if you don't work for the WWE, how can you be the world champion? So that means you were only champion for an hour and 12 minutes, and then you forfeited the title. Now, if Mr. Cena here cares to give you a rematch, then we can talk contracts from there. John, would you like to give him a rematch? And then Cena can give him the eye, you can't see me. No, I ain't giving you no rematch. Well, we've got a bit of a dilemma here, Punk. He doesn't want to give you a rematch, and he doesn't have to. And oh, by the way, thank you for the 3-year, 5-year, 10-year deal he signed with us, whatever the fuck they want to say he signed. And I guess you're going to have to start at the bottom of the barrel, CM Punk. And oh, by the way, who's the doofus now? Good luck to you. And then you got all that fucking heat on H, because obviously H is going to get some anyway. Now if you want a little heat on Cena, you got some on him, and you got Punk standing there feeling like he just got the biggest 13 and a half inch dick rammed up his ass he ever had, and the fans feeling sorry for him. And now you got the biggest baby face in the fucking company, because now he's got to start at the bottom of where he thought he was at the top and then work his way back up and win the fucking title he had already won. What do you guys think of that? I know what the Prince thought.
Well, I have one comment to make. I did watch like 5 minutes of the, I guess, it was at the opening segment where it was Triple H and CM Punk, or was that at the end of the...
That was at the beginning
of the show, yeah.
Beginning of the show, where Triple H, now, Did I hear this correctly when I heard it? Did he call CM Punk a skinny fat ass?
He did. Yeah. We both, everybody in his house commented on that.
What the hell?
Called him a skinny fat ass. We're all bumfuzzled on that one as well. And that's what's called is when your brain takes an extra rev amongst about what you're coming out of your mouth. I've done it before, and that's what happened to
Triple H. Oh, I've done it before.
Triple H
got creative lost. Editing nobody knew, but I've done it before.
Triple H got lost in his promo, and it's all right. That just shows how amped up he was. I got no problem with that. But, yeah.
Yeah, that happened. Well, of all the bad things you can say about Triple H, I mean...
And there was plenty bad said about Triple H during the promo. Now, that's what I did like, is because everything Punk said about him was just dead god-awful true. And then everything
he could have said so much worse.
He could have. And if he really wanted to get on him, because he's now in charge of talent relations, he took JR's job, he should have hammered him on, by the way, I'm a product of OVW. Well, if OVW wants to lay claim to me, I thought I was a star before I got there. And then everybody he named was a product of OVW.
Except Bolin.
He could have talked about how they dropped the ball with OVW and all the stars we produced. And by the way, that little place y'all developed down in Florida that you're now in charge of, how many stars have they produced? Millionaire geniuses? Huh? How many? You can't name any fucking, can you? And that would have been... But, you know...
They're going to claim Riley.
Yeah, they can have Riley, if you want to call him a star yet. I don't think he's there yet.
No, he's nowhere near, but they'll claim Riley because he's got so much potential.
And they can have Sheamus. We had nothing to do with Sheamus, and whatever he is, they can have him.
Sheamus Florida or Georgia? I don't remember. It seemed like he was Georgia.
I don't remember Sheamus in Georgia, to be honest with you.
He came up around the same time MVP did, didn't he?
Well, you know what? He probably got his starts in Georgia, now that you mention it.
Well, wasn't Sheamus... Sheamus was in Europe, wasn't he, before then?
Yeah, but I'm talking WWE system development.
Yeah, it's like Punk was kind of what he was before we got a hold of him, but Heyman saw something...
Punk was well ahead of what he was.
He's right. Heyman saw something in him. Cornette didn't. I thought he was good, but I didn't see him as a world heavyweight champion. And I'm going to be honest with you, I really still don't. Because when you see
him, when I was 15, that motherfucker was the business.
You did. You told me that, and I guess in a way you were right. But when he's standing there, bowing up on the Triple H's and some of the bigger talent that's in the John Cena's. He doesn't look like he's in the same league. He looks like an independent worker. And
you're talking about two of the biggest, and you can say what you want about John Cena not being on HGH or Growth or steroids or whatever you want to say. I don't.
Well, he's on something that I'm not on. Let's put it that way.
I mean, I know a lot of shit. You know me. I mean, I'm not going to get into it here. I like John. He's a good guy, but that's not a natural body. There's no fucking way that's a natural body.
You look at Cena's head and you look at Triple H's head, and they do look somewhat similar.
Yeah, and we all know that Triple H is one of the biggest abusers there is. And if you want to put a guy who CM Punk to me has a normal athletic build, if you had gone, I mean, it's not like the Luthez athletic or the Carl Gotch athletic, but he's got a normal athletic guy build.
How many normal athletic guys have been the world heavyweight champion in your lifetime other than Shawn Michaels?
But that's not what I'm getting at. I'm saying that because they've mutated what our idea of a champion should be to quite literally a mutant, I'm not going to take that
that's
away from one
that's
guy
what's
than
been
after
done. And WWE mutated that quicker than anybody.
Oh, Jerry they did. Lawler, I agree.
Jerry Lawler was a normal-looking human being, and we bought him being champion. We bought Terry Funk being champion.
Buried the guys who were the muscle heads because they couldn't move, and that was the old promos. I know. I mean, I've seen it.
We bought Dusty Rhodes being champion. We bought Ric Flair being champion. But in the WWE, it had to be the Backlunds. It had to be the Hulk Hogans.
Backlund was never that jacked, though.
I don't know.
Backlund was more of a Nokia's build than he was.
Who the fuck's trying to call me?
Backlund had more of a Nokia build in his prime than he did a Hogan build.
Chris, you carry this. This is Adam Revolver. I'm going to take this. You carry the show for a bit.
All right, but the issue with this is, and I understand what he's saying, that Punk does not have the body of your average WWE champion. He doesn't. That's fine. It's completely That's a fair point.
That was important.
But the issue with that is that WWE is the reason that they've created that body image. If they want to try to get back now to a more natural image, Punk's the guy to do that, because who looks less roided up than CM Punk?
Kind of made sense. He's his dad.
You know what I'm saying, Rob?
Promos.
Right.
I can't hear you without that saying revolver. I'm trying to fucking talk about this shit.
Damn it, King, put your mic on mute.
What'd you say?
I said, damn it, King, put your mic on mute.
But that's the whole fucking thing of it is that we're trying to get to a new era of pro wrestling with all things CM Punk represents, that he is this new stage of the business.
I'm not even really worried about it.
But it's just one of those things. If he's going to be the new age of the business, we have to start moving in more guys that body type. Paul Cabana, I don't know if you ever saw it, we used to a gimmick called Matt Classic, where he basically wrestled a very old school body working style. He'd wear very old school tights, and he had a build like a Gotcha says, and it worked. To me, that's the body style we need to be promoting more than the fucking Lesnar's and the Batistas and the Triple H's and the Cena's.
We're having way
more guys.
The Paradise will see this differently, but I think.
I think another one, and I don't know about if he was ever on roids or anything like that. At least he never appeared like that to me with Sting.
Sting?
Yeah, he never looked like he was just roided up like a freak, and you know what I mean?
I would assume back in his Blade Runner days that he was. I would assume that probably during the Surfer era that he probably was.
And,
I think once they put him into the Crow outfit, he didn't really have to be anymore. He did most of his body. I think that's a pretty big deal for that. You know, kind of gets rid of that whole need to do that.
Number one.
Right.
But WWE hates guys in singlets. I mean, can you think of anybody there that still wears one?
What's that again? I'm sorry.
Can you actually think of anybody there who still wears a singlet in WWE that actually covers up that part of their body? I can't think of anybody.
No. I can't think of anybody that.
And that goes into Vince's super body fetish, which is fine. That's what Vince likes to promote. But he's always talking about cleaning up the business and making it more accessible to the everyman. John Cena is not the everyman. John Cena is promoted as the everyman. CM Punk is probably closer to it. He's somebody that's very capable of promoting that image.
Like I said, even
can if you mute his mic?
There's 5,300 people in there. He needs to do something that night.
Can you mute his mic at all, Rob?
No, he's still talking about Revolver and Paradise in the background. I can hear him.
Ah, for the love of God. How about professional, Rob? He wonders why people won't pay for this. That's all. Think of it. What other topics do you have? And if he needs to come back on this, he can.
Let's see here. I've got some. I talked to your dad about this, off the air before we actually started recording. Maurice apparently has a stalker. I don't know if you've read about that or not.
I have actually. I've seen that. It's really sad. It's horrible. But that is an issue of being a celebrity in this social networking era. Everybody is so accessible around the clock, 24/7. Everybody has access to everybody. And that's dangerous. I mean, I got a little girl. She's 2 years old.
Yeah.
And I wonder what I'm going to do with her when she gets to this age. It's something that really concerns me because they do want that. They need that connection. With my Asperger's, I don't need it. I got to Facebook promote myself and to put myself over. I don't give a fuck. Maybe people talk to me on it. But that's the whole...
Right. You still there?
Okay. All right, I need to get back to the radio show here because we just lost Chris, so let me get back to the radio show, and we'll finish up more on this tomorrow then. All right, my boy, be good. All right, Dickon, are you there?
Yeah, I'm still here. I think we lost Chris.
I had a promotional call come in, and that was from OBW, and I had to take that. Looks like we lost the Prince there, but I'm sure that he will... He'll dial back in. He may, God knows where he's at. Hell, he's liable to be in Ethiopia or something. He apparently lost us. It looks like he's back in.
I am back in. Are we there back doing a fucking show?
I guess you dropped for a few seconds.
I had to handle some OVW business, and that's why there's two of us here. If one
if one of us stops talking, the other one's fully capable of taking over. Had it been an important...
Well, the problem is that you didn't stop talking. You kept talking over what I was trying to talk about and had to keep fucking going over you.
There's no way you could hear me. Did you all hear me?
We could hear you clear as day.
Yeah, I heard I heard a couple names mentioned there. I heard, well, obviously it was Revolver, but I heard Paradise in there. And
yeah, fuck him. hogging up the whole fucking show. Well, sorry about that. I didn't realize that microphone was that goddamn sensitive. So, well, I guess y'all got to hear OVW business going down as we speak here. I'm either sorry about that or glad y'all got a sneak peek, one of the two. But
well, the thing of it is that we were talking about the whole body image deal, and you said that Backlund was all jacked up. To me, Backlund never had the body of a Hulk Hogan. He had the body of a Road Warrior. He never had the Ultimate Warrior physique. He was in shape, but it was much more of a healthy, legitimate in
shape.
Well,
I give you that he wasn't to their level, but he also wasn't Shawn Michaels either.
No, but Backlund was also a world-class athlete at that. Shawn Michaels was never that. He was a normal guy.
Seems like Dickens somehow is trying to turn you and I against each other. We've spent more time arguing with each other than we have these ignorant wrestling fans out here don't know what the hell's going on in the wrestling business.
I'm a bit of a Bob Backlund, Mark, and I'm not going to put Bob Backlund in the same category as a lot of those guys.
Never was a Backlund, Mark. I thought it was 7 years of wasted time or however long he had it. I was not a Backlund, Mark, at all.
It was about 7 years with a few breaks for a Nokia in there that I don't recognize.
Should have had it
there, damn it.
I remember one time he had it for a week. That was good enough for me.
He had it for a week and lost it in like 6 seconds to Kevin Nash.
Nah, that's, well, and everyone knows that that's about all Kevin Nash can go.
Yeah, right, well, the right sad part of that is that you...
Before right
he,
about
is
six...
That Kevin Nash was the second, it was the second lowest drawing champion and the lowest drawing until Batista killed the company.
Yeah, and there was Punk last night once again saying that he doesn't necessarily know everything he's talking about. He said WWE dropped the ball on Batista. I don't know who the fuck got more opportunities to get over than Batista, short of Brock Lesnar. Name me the guy.
Batista's a good utility upper mid-carder who can get people over right before they're ready to go to the main event. Not
right.
Because of his work rate, but just because of his size. If you beat Batista, it's believable that you could beat a bigger guy.
Only person,
he can never carry anybody. He couldn't even carry himself.
Only person I know that got more television time, and some might say that he did not deserve it, might be Santino Marella. And I don't know who he's pissed off lately, but where the fuck did his TV time go?
The problem with Santino is that at least he's entertaining. He's not the best.
Well, exactly.
Man.
Just entertain me. Just entertain me. If you got an invisible dog you walk around the ring, if that makes me chuckle, so be it. If you got
and
a
Milano Collection 8, he did have that.
If you got a fucking bird on your shoulder and people like that, you know, it's different.
If you have a 6-minute dance routine entrance, that entertains me.
That does entertain me. It doesn't necessarily make you the world champion. And I've always said...
Although Magnum was on a couple of occasions.
As I've always said, different stages, different levels to the show. And yes, when I bought a ticket to go to the Louisville Gardens, I bought my ticket to see Jerry Lawler versus Terry Funk or Jerry Lawler versus Jimmy Valiant. But if that was the only match of the night, I'd have probably been pissed, even though I didn't particularly give that much a shit about the other matches in most cases. I'd have been pissed if I didn't get the whole piece of pie.
Well, you and I have had to have that conversation with one of the newer members of Bolin Services.
If I didn't get Benzo the Wrestling Bear.
Well, you and I have had to have this conversation recently with one of the newer OVW guys, and we've had to explain to him that, you know, not everybody is going to be that top main event guy. You have
no,
to have the ability guys. You have to have the guys that are there to get people over. You have to have people that are getting people ready to be the main event guy. And you have to have people that are just like to carry everybody. I mean, I'm sorry that Chavo Guerrero decided to quit or whatever. But in talking about needing to be world champion, I don't believe Chavo Guerrero beating Butter with an outboard motor. It's just not something
I
actually believe.
Heard that line somewhere before. Who? Yeah, okay.
Yeah. It's not an original Prince, but it holds true.
It does hold true.
Chavo
Guerrero, not even on your best imagination, is a world heavyweight champion in any, not even TNA.
No, but he's a fantastic worker.
I agree with
him. But he's there to carry people. He's there to make people look good. I'm sorry, that's the business. Not everybody's going to be fucking Batista or Triple H or Randy Orton or CM Punk or John Cena. You know what? You need Radford Tendall. You need the Brooklyn Brawler. That's part of the business.
Yeah.
So, I'm not really going to go in and...
The Doink the Clowns or whatever? Yeah, well, maybe not Doink, but...
You have to have utility workers. I mean, you have to have just the good hands to get people over. And nobody wants to be that guy anymore. Everybody thinks they're world champion material.
Every independent worker that contacts me swears to God they're better than anybody that OVW has got or has ever had, and they are world champion material, and then I look at their picture, and Prince, you know, you're not even training to be a pro wrestler, and I would be more legit to put a title on you than I would 95% of these guys.
Well, the thing of it is that I can at least talk somebody into a show. I mean, that's my skill.
Well, you're 6'2", 255 pounds. You look
and
like
I can
a man.
Beat people's asses.
But you look like a man. You look like you can whip somebody. You're not the prototypical manager. But because you're smart, because you've got a decent physique for a man, you've got the double. You got the double thing going for you. You can beat them with your mind, and goddamn, if it comes right down to it, they may not know it yet, but you might be able to beat them with your body as well. Much like
I very easily
Bischoff.
Killed most of them. But the thing with it is that you've been there with us in the beginning of the shows before it gets started. A lot of us in the heel area are sitting down watching the tapes these jackoffs send and laughing at them because it's sad.
I know.
It's sad that they think that they can actually do this, and they can't. They're
And remember, that's what they're sending us. Imagine what we're not seeing.
Do you remember a couple of years ago when a guy sent us a tape? I don't even remember who the fuck he was. He was wrestling somewhere in northern Kentucky. And there was a guy at a bingo hall on a live microphone making fun of what he was saying in the ring doing commentary.
Yeah, I recall that.
Yeah, I mean, and this is what they send to us, thinking this is going to impress us enough to bring them in. I mean, I got a decent amount of say over who comes in and out of what we do, and... Why would I stick my neck out for that guy?
Yeah. Well, Dickon, we're not really letting you ask a whole hell of a lot of questions here. I'm sure you got some topics for us to cover.
Sure. Well, me and I start talking about Maryse when my phone drops and this new stalking thing she's got going on.
Yeah. Well, let's get into that because I don't know a whole lot about that, but apparently the Prince, I'm sure the Prince.
Well, Rob, catch him up, and then I'll re-explain my stance on it.
So apparently, Maryse, it all started on Twitter. This guy, which seemed to me, when I was looking back at the tweets that this guy was sending her, seemed to me like a spammer. Now, he was sending stuff about, Maryse, contact me. My name is Lee. I have an investment opportunity for oil and skyscraper properties.
Okay, and the first dumb fuck that replies to that needs their fucking head lopped off.
So,
all right, there's my response to that.
So he sent probably, I'm looking through all the tweets, hundreds of these to her.
Rob Dickon, would you reply to that tweet?
No, I would block him.
No, Prince, would you reply to that tweet?
Yes, with a disposable phone number and as much humor as I can possibly muster.
Well, you and I would have some fun with it, but I mean, answering that call expecting to get an investment at an oil deal in a foreign country somewhere?
No, you fuck with the guy.
Well, of course you fuck with the guy. I always tell him I can't wait to invest. How much money do you need? Where can I wire it? Have you got the money yet? I fuck with all of them. But if
can
she
I invest
responded,
solely in Cuban pesos? I mean, these are the questions you ask.
Well, absolutely. Absolutely. Can I send it to you in quarters? I have a lot of quarters. I've never spent any of them.
My money is currently tied up exclusively in the North Korean yuan. Can I give you that?
Can I pay you off in Labradors?
Do I buy stock in your company by trading for stock in my dog breeding industry?
Wait a minute, that price, that's not a fair price. I would like to pay more.
Sir, I feel as though you're taking advantage of me at the moment.
I'm not taking advantage of you. Yeah, I'm not here to fuck you. Come on, jack the price up a little.
But make me feel better. The issue is that... Alright, so Rob, finish telling him what's going on, then I'll catch him up with my stance.
So, apparently, after she, I'm not sure if she blocked this guy or what went on with it. I mean, after about the first 100 tweets, I think she would have blocked him. But,
I would hope so.
But apparently, she thinks that the same guy is sending her text messages and leaving her voicemails.
Right.
And my question is, if it's the same guy, how did he get her phone number?
Well, no. Chances are it's stored through Twitter on some sort of a server that he knew how to get into. If you're updating your Twitter through your phone, that's easy information to get, which most people do. I do it. But the problem is that I'm actually a scary person. I'll fucking murder somebody. Or, you know, you're being scary.
Prince, we've had enough trouble this weekend. Let's not be admitting to murdering anybody.
I didn't say that I have. I said I'm willing to. I'm capable of it.
Muscagney's had enough to do this week without getting you out of a... having Raymond Burr sit alongside of him.
But okay, so the whole issue with this is that what I was saying before I got cut off is that I think that we as people are overexposed. I think that the social networking thing has gotten way too far for the average human being. I mean, my father and I, we're, you know, public people. We're personalities. We exist in a different universe, and we have to be accessible in that. But the fact that, you know, I'm getting friends requests now from 13-year-old girls on Facebook. And it's like, why the fuck do your parents let you do this? Where the fuck is your family? This isn't safe. You don't know what I'm about.
And what's even worse is those same 13, 14, and 15-year-old girls request me, a 51-year-old man. And then if I accept them, trying to be a celebrity who, here, what can I do for you? What can I answer your question? But if you talk to them, you're a bad person, and if you don't accept them, you're a bad person.
Yeah, and then and then Cornette takes a shot at you about it.
Well, that's not even my issue. My issue isn't so much our role in this. I mean, I know that I'm not going to do anything with these girls. I know that I'm not going to say anything inappropriate to these girls. But the issue is that they're available to me.
That is the reason I don't worry about it, and Prince is right. They're available. They're making themselves available to us, but we know we're not going to say anything inappropriate. They're not going to get anything on us type that we shouldn't have said, so we don't worry about it.
It's not even trying to incriminate me. I've got a 3-year-old daughter that I think about this shit with because, you know, she's getting to the age. It's going to happen eventually. And here's two. I'm going to turn around. She's going to be 12, and then she's going to want a Facebook or whatever the trending thing is then.
And here's the bottom line. Here's the bottom line, Prince. We controlled this in OVW years ago when MySpace first became available. Anybody in OVW that got caught with a fucking MySpace page was kicked out of the company, no questions asked. If you were told not to have one, Romeo Roselli was one of the first. He was on there pimping himself out on fucking Facebook. Or not Facebook, but MySpace. And we dictated that, and it was easy enough. Do you want to work for this company? Then you ain't going to be on MySpace telling our fucking business. And it's easy enough.
The thing is that the WWE is using it to promote. It's part of their gimmick now. It's part of the company.
But it's not needed. It's not
needed.
To them, it is.
I mean, a lot of the CM Punk thing came about because of Twitter, because of Facebook, because of YouTube.
And the television ratings went down 12%. That's how much of an impact it had.
Over the last year, the facts are the facts. What was precipitating going into this new summer of punk? What was leading into this? What do people have to give a shit about?
Well, nothing. I mean, I'm telling you, the summer of punk is a smart mark. Is a smart mark entertainment extravaganza. I don't think the real wrestling fans particularly give a shit, and that's why 12% of them elected not to tune back in.
But I think it would have been even fewer tuned back in if not for the summer of punk.
The ratings did not go up 12%. They went down 12%. That's a 24%.
They went down 12% over last year.
Exactly. In other words, it was shittier week to week. It was shittier last year than it is now.
I don't know about that.
But if this little spark didn't boost business at least some over last year, I'm not getting that fucking excited about it. When my ratings...
Okay, but last year you had the Orton Cena feud that was damn good. Then you had Jeff Hardy...
And done to death. Orton Cena's been done to death. If I ever see another
one... Okay, and also you had Taker Punk coming up, and then you had Taker somebody else that everybody got into.
You know how much of a chance I give Punk against Taker in a fucking real fight? That would be none.
None at all. But I'm saying that it captivated people. People wanted to see that.
Prince, all we're doing is arguing with each other.
That's because I think we have conflicting points on this.
Well, I'd rather argue with the fans of America. Can we take calls on this thing, Dickon?
With me and you.
Grand Rapids, Michigan.
Where me, you, and Stacy were at BW3s watching that pay-per-view to where Punk put away Jeff to send him out of the company, and the bell hit and Taker showed up and chokeslammed him. Everybody popped that, including Stacy, who fucking hates pro wrestling.
Yeah.
That got people into it because it was captivating. What this summer before Punk was captivating? What this summer had people into wrestling? It was the fucking status quo.
It's just hard for me to get too high on the bandwagon of 185-pound, tattooed-up, multi-pierced, greasy-headed, so-called straight-edge guy.
Hey, that's what straight-edge was. I mean, back when it was admitted by guys that looked way worse than him.
I'm straight-edge. No, nothing that the good Lord didn't give me coming in. No additional holes, no metal, no ink.
Okay, for the record, you and I are both AC, so the good Lord defense doesn't really hold up here.
What's that now?
The good Lord doesn't exist. It's a fucking fairy tale. I don't need to hear about your relationship with your imaginary friend. It doesn't matter to me.
Hey. My imaginary relationship is with Captain Kangaroo.
And if that's who you want to pray to, that makes just about as much sense as any of the other ones to me.
Well, that's who I picked, Captain Kangaroo.
All right, next topic. He and I are never going to agree about this social media thing. I say it's dangerous, but we need to watch it and back
up. I say any pro athlete ought to be banned from social media because the dumb fucks don't know how to use it.
I have my questions about you, but
they always put out shit that they shouldn't be saying. They're a bunch of dumb fucks, and they shouldn't even be on it. And that goes for the wrestlers, the football players, the baseball players.
Well, football players are way worse than wrestlers.
And the goddamn what do you call them? Those what's that game you play in Canada with a thing and you throw it?
Curling.
Yeah. They shouldn't be allowed to. Well, they can Twitter. Let them Twitter. They need.
Let the curling teams tweet.
Yeah, they can Twitter, but everybody else is fucked.
Okay, so next topic, Rob.
Well, I'm going to make a comment on the social media thing so I can be kind of the medium.
Please do.
I can be kind of the medium. I think that it goes a little too far. Hold on.
I can't hear a fucking word you're saying.
As you get ready to say something, Dickon, your microphone dies out.
I think if they're going to be on Facebook, if they're going to be on MySpace, they should be...
Nobody's on MySpace.
They should be kayfabing it. Because the only person that does it well on Facebook and Twitter and whatever, there's a couple of them, is The Rock and John Cena.
Yeah, they do it very well. I mean, theirs is only there to build up angles, which to me is completely okay. That's not my concern. But my concern is people treating it like real life, like Maurice did.
Well, Cena accidentally posted a naked picture of himself the other day on Twitter.
No, that was ARI that did that.
No, it was Cena.
No,
had to apologize for it.
But I can see Cena doing that in real life and thinking it's fucking hilarious.
Well, Cena did it just the other day and then had to apologize immediately because he was sending it to a girl that asked for it and he ended up sending it to everybody.
Yeah, isn't he fucking married anyway?
Yes, he is. Well, he was. He may not be after this week.
Okay, so back to what I was saying, but I mean, as somebody who has a 2-year-old, that genuinely do work.
Manager, dumb fucks.
Old Wiener Jr.
Everybody, this whole business is full of nothing but dumb fucks. I mean, I think we're all pretty much aware of that.
Well, we've been saying that for many years now.
All right, so next topic, Rob.
Are we cutting out again?
Kankakee, Illinois, are you there?
All right, we're here. Well, the next topic is...
Mickey Mouse operation you got going here?
I thought we left Mickey Mouse when we left that other fucking show.
I told King that I'd duct tape...
What was that other show called? Who's Dickin' Who? And now we come over here to Dickless Dickin'.
All right, so what's the next topic?
Next topic is Sin Cara has been caught with anabolic steroids and is suspended.
This is another one me and him are going to argue about because I'm completely pro steroids.
Don't go on this one, but go ahead.
I think they should be completely legalized and supervised by doctors like they are in Japan, where there is no negative outcome, so it's actually safe for the guys to do them. Because they're going to do them no matter what we do anyway. It's nothing we can possibly stop. It also improves the quality of the sports we're watching. Baseball's more interesting. Football's more interesting. Like Daniel Sosh said, I want the best athletes science can possibly create. And the fact that he's having to hide behind this and say, oh, you know, whatever, it was some common pain medication in Mexico, I don't give a shit. He's a fucking world-class athlete who does incredible things that nobody else can do, and he's probably going to be as close to an Alfonso as that country has anymore. Well, if he's on fucking steroids, who gives a shit?
One of the comedians recently said that each, and it might have been Conan O'Brien or Jay Leno, I can't remember which one it was, but he said that, that was George Carlin. George Carlin said it.
Well, then it wasn't recent.
Well, recent in my mind. It was before 76. And Carlin said that each team ought to have one motherfucker on a team that can roid up as much as he goddamn wants to. And when that sumbitch comes to the plate, everybody's going to be paying attention. The St. Louis Cardinals did that. His name was Mark McGwire. And the Oakland A's did it. His name was Jose Canseco when Mark McGwire was with him. But that was two on the same team. You couldn't do that, and that's why McGwire had to go. And do it in football, do it in basketball. Do it in every sport. Every sport gets one roided up monkey they can put on the team. And he can do whatever the fuck he wants. Make it interesting.
Okay, but how does that pertain to pro wrestling or a pro wrestling show?
Well, yeah, okay, well, I guess it fucks everything up because you only got one wrestler that can do it. Chances are, Triple H will stay undefeated.
Yeah, that's true. Bring back Goldberg, fuck.
Can't do that.
All right.
Next question.
Next topic is, Sting is world champion again.
boring DNA anecdote.
Have you seen this shit, Chris? Prince, have you seen it?
No, I'll put it over. I know he's doing like a Joker gimmick, but...
This Joker bullshit he's doing, and he even sucks at it. He's 54, 55, or he might even be older. How old is he?
I honestly don't... He's in his mid-50s.
He's in his mid-50s at least. Well, that's a step up from the 65-year-old man that doesn't want to give it up. We back down 10 years. And give it to a guy who does a horrible Joker impersonation.
And is he actually trying to do the Joker gimmick? I mean, what's he trying to do?
Well,
he's trying to do the Joker, in my opinion. Dickon, you probably watch it more than I do. What's your spin?
Well, from my understanding, TNA ripped that gimmick off a guy that's been sending tapes to him. and his name is Crimson, I guess. And
Crimson,
They ripped off his name.
I thought they already had a Crimson.
Well, they did. They ripped off his name, and they ripped off his gimmick.
Well, that'll teach you to send in tapes, won't it? Well, I got a little secret for you. And I probably shouldn't tell this, but I'm going to do it anyway. Jerry Jarrett was going to start a wrestling promotion here a couple, 3 years ago. And when he heard me and Cornette going back and forth on the Bolin Alley and wanted to host the Great Debate and all that, he placed a phone call to me. And wanted me to be a part of his company, and I thought he wanted Kenny Bolin. Well, he didn't. He wanted pretty much the character that you're seeing in TNA right now, only wanted him as a manager instead of a wrestler. And Jarrett came up with that about 3 or 4 years ago, and my problem was that it was a little too much like the Joker, and it sure as fuck wasn't me. I didn't think that I could portray that character. And Jarrett says, do you realize how many people have ever turned down a job from me in the history of my career? He said, that would be none. He said, I appreciate your honesty and you telling me that you didn't think that you could give me what I want out of this character. He says, I think you could, but if you're convinced you're not able to do it, then guess what? You're not going to be able to do it. Because if you in your head can't admit you can do it, then you're beat to begin with. I said, well, I'm beat because I don't think I can do it.
Yeah, apparently this guy... His name is Crimson. He had talked to D'Lo Brown and I guess Terry Taylor when he was there and a couple other people that, you know, he was supposed to be brought in as this Crimson character with the Joker sort of gimmick. And what ended up happening was he got ripped off two ways.
Well, if you're stupid enough to send that shit in and think somebody ain't going to steal it, you're an idiot.
I think it was in Beyond the Mats where Albert said, stealing it.
Oh, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
You got to copyright that shit first, and even then you're not really safe because all they got to do is tweak it a little. So, no, that's not very smart.
I mean, there was a rule in OVW for a long time that don't do anything cool until you're on the main roster.
Oh, no, shit. Because, every time the WWE guys would be down here, and Chris just said it perfectly.
If they were sitting on the back room watching on the monitor, oh, look at that, oh, stealing that. And then it would be done in WWE long before you got there. So it don't do you any good to show that shit off.
And I mean, if you want to ask anybody for proof of this, ask Chris Daniels. Whose shit has been stolen more than Chris Daniels?
And I'm not trying to lay credit for all of this, but the briefcase was all... Now, the Halliburton had been heard of, but the briefcase was all but unheard of in pro wrestling until I started using one. I don't know anybody that used a briefcase every week at ringside. The Halliburton, yeah, because it was a big, heavy metal fucking thing, and that had its purpose. But the briefcase hardly ever used. Well, what's the big thing with WWE right now? Every fucking year, Money in the Bank, they pack the fucking briefcases around all year. And I think that's a little bit of a steal to my gimmick. Because I'm the only one I know that ever had a briefcase.
Yeah.
All right, so what's the
next one? I got the Prince. I'm hoping the Prince breaks out that thing that he's been working on. I think he's got something that's going to be rather unique to wrestling, too, but we'll save that.
So what were you saying? What's the next topic, Rob?
Considering, I guess, ROH had, they've taped their first episode, or they're getting ready to do that for TV. I don't know if that's, you know, happened yet or not. I've kind of seen some tweets about it.
What tweets have you seen, and I'll confirm or deny?
Well, it's been from Sin. I've seen some...
Well, there you go. Pretty reliable source. You ought to have a pretty good idea what you've been reading.
I've just been reading that they were getting ready to do it, or actually that Jimmy has been working hard to, you know...
From what I understand, and if I'm speaking out of turn, and so be it, from what I understand, they've been getting some pre-production ready down in Florida, from what I understand, and they're about ready to start doing some tapings here real soon.
Gotcha.
That's kind of what I understood.
Now, for all of the fans that are out there that actually watch ROH, now, you probably know this more than I do.
Well, hang on. Are both of y'all on? Are both of you listening? Okay.
I'm here.
Yep.
Both of the fans that watch ROH.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah. Well,
I want to make sure both of them are listening right now so they can hear us.
I mean, ROH is kind of what got me back into pro wrestling. It got me loving it again back right after WCW died. I mean, when they first came off and it was all the Joe show, I mean, that's what made me love pro wrestling. I didn't give a shit before that. I'd completely gotten out of it. And going to those shows and seeing CM Punk and Samoa Joe and all the Special K guys and Amazing Red, I mean, to me, that's what pro wrestling was. But as always, to try to go more mainstream and get out of the arenas.
Christopher would cover half the country to go see an ROH show. He could give less than a rat's ass about seeing WWE.
Yeah. And they've kind of gotten away from that, and they've kind of tried to go more mainstream and have more mainstream-looking guys, like Davey Richards is this fucking big muscle-bound motherfucker. I think they've lost a lot of what made them Ring of Honor, and I couldn't care less if they live or die now. I mean, if the company succeeds, wonderful, I'm glad they've made it. It's an alternative. But it's not the Ring of Honor that I was attached to, you know?
Right. And
Dick, and this is off wrestling a bit, but what's your opinion, and of course the Prince's opinion, because I don't think I've really talked with him a whole lot about it, about this freak in Norway, this Republican right-wing Christianer, one of God's people, killing them 93 kids.
Here's my thing, because I'm going to give you a little bit of what I think about it, and then I'll let Chris chime in. But here's my thing about it. I actually tuned into Fox News. I never watch Fox News, but I had actually tuned into it because I thought...
If I want to hear the other side, I'd tune into Fox News.
Because I thought it would be funny just to see what they were actually saying about it.
Well, Christian, Republican, right-winger, killing people. I'm sure he had a self-defense mode.
Right, and here's the thing. The sheriff over there had said he was right-wing, very extreme right-wing. He was religiously motivated as a Christian.
Yep.
And
what I read.
I tune in to Fox News, and they're saying that there's no evidence that he was right-wing. There's no evidence. There's no evidence that he was Christian. There was more evidence that he was Muslim.
Oh, of course he was. Those were the very people that he was pissed off that were coming here. Yeah, okay. Well, that's good old Fox News for you.
Yeah, so that was my thing on it, was just that...
Well, I hope we don't offend... I hope we don't offend too many people here, but one thing I've ever noticed, if you want to meet an asshole, have them attach the moniker to their name, Republican or Christian. Normally, you're about to meet an asshole.
My whole thing is, and we all know that I'm a firm anti-religion person. I think that all religion is despicable and should be done away with. It's horrible for humanity. It holds back society. It needs to be forgotten.
But yet, you and I are such caring, loving, decent people that use our left and right turn indicators in our car.
I swear to God, I don't even know the promo you're reciting. I don't think anybody does. It's me, you, and Cornette.
Well, that's okay.
The three.
They're going to learn. They're going to learn.
But it's a joke. It's a joke to people. Let their imaginary friend determine what they're going to do with their lives, how they're going to interact with other people. It is sad. I can't believe that we as a society in the year 2011, going into 2012, are still letting this determine things. We're still letting this affect how we treat other people.
81% of the people let this happen to them.
I mean, I'm all for killing people. I think it's wonderful. Population control, yay. But don't determine it by your imaginary friend. It's pathetic. It is sad. It's unforgivable. I can't believe that we are still doing this.
I think me and you might disagree on the killing people. I mean, just for no reason?
No, but, I mean, I think there's a reason, but I think that at the same time, there's a lot of people in this planet who simply don't need to be here.
But a lot of people had a problem.
My little girl's real dad has no business on this earth. He's a horrible fucking father.
He doesn't.
He's a horrible fucking person. Let him out.
Any father who doesn't show up on his daughter's birthday and have a present for her second birthday should be shot in the fucking head. I'll agree with that.
I'm glad to hear that. But at the same time, to say that, you know, over a religion is the reason to do that, that's insane. It's unforgivable. Religion has to die so that humanity can progress.
Religion has killed more people than anything on this planet. And no one gets that. And that's, I know that we're almost sounding like an episode of Cornette Show here to where we start talking about religion and politics. But
well, it's brought up.
Well, I think I brought it up.
Yeah, well,
it's
funny.
It comes up. I mean, it's part of the world. We're a current event show as much as anything.
But I know what decent people you and I are and all the help that we try to provide for people. I'm known for having my finger in the youth of America. And I know what you do. And both of us will help a decent, common, decent human being who tries to help themselves. And it's those who won't pick up the bootstraps and help themselves that we got a problem with.
I mean, I'm all for picking somebody while they're down, so long as they're not trying to get back up.
Well, yeah.
But I do more to help people in the average week than the average Christian does in a lifetime.
Yeah.
It's pathetic that I'm viewed as the bad guy because I don't read a fucking book for my guidance in life.
And at least you know where we stand.
I mean, I'll tell you if I don't like you. I have no issue with that. I'll tell you if I care if you die. I'll tell you if I'm going to try to help make you die.
I know that when people I don't like die, it makes me happy.
I could generally care less when they die unless I think they're a bad person.
But I will be very sad when Ernie Borgnine dies, even though I've been predicting it since 1979.
Ernie Borgnine's not going to die. Don't even talk like that.
I don't
You're
going to
get your hopes up.
It's not looking good for me. I think Borgnine might be God.
He could be, but okay, so we've established that. Fuck the right wing, fuck religion. What do you got?
Well, as far as politics go, they passed the debt deal.
thank God for that.
Too late, not going to help. It's just, like I said, too little too late.
None of my Democrat friends were going to be able to get their welfare checks. The military wasn't going to get paid. Ma Bolin wasn't going to get her SSI check. All my beloved OVW fans on disability, they weren't going to get their check. Therefore, they couldn't pay to come and see me. It would have been a great disaster.
Well, of course, and we got to cut off all those people just so we can, you know, save those tax cuts for all those billionaires.
Can you imagine not sending the military a check? They're over here fighting their fucking asses off for a bullshit fucking war, and then their wives and children are getting evicted at home. Because they can't get a paycheck.
Yep.
Aren't you allowed to quit your job when they quit paying you? Can't you drop?
Well, here's the thing, and this is how it's going to come up: is that the ones who they wouldn't pay would be overseas, unable to do anything about it, and the ones that keep paying are the ones here in basic, who are the ones who would be able to revolt. America would do anything it could to stop a revolt. They pay the ones who are in a position to fight them. The ones who aren't, fuck them. They're
the ones who are actually. The ones who are actually earning their $312 a week over there putting their life on the line every day for bullshit that most of them don't even believe in or want to be a part of. They just have they're a victim of circumstance, as one great man once said. Curly.
Curly?
Yeah, Curly. He was great.
All right, next topic.
I've been keeping up with movies. Have you guys been watching any movies lately?
We'll chime in. What do you got?
I actually caught X-Men First Class.
I shouldn't admit it, but I have that. I possess that now.
Excellent, excellent movie. They should have started off the series with this movie. The third X-Men.
I've watched about 45 minutes of it. I haven't watched the whole thing yet.
The third X-Men movie was so poorly freaking done that, I don't.
Chris, the third was a little weak, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
I enjoyed the first two, though.
So this one should have been how the series actually started. It was very well done. I like the story. You got to see
Kevin Bacon looks like he does a great job in this.
Yes, he does a very good job in it. And
yeah, I'm about 40 minutes.
Yeah, he's
Prince,
actually.
I'm surprised you haven't hit me up for a copy yet, Prince. You're an X-Men fan. Why do you not have this movie yet?
Well, the only fucking movies I see anymore. I watched Strawberry Shortcake the day before I went into work, because I tell you where my movies are at these days.
Son, I've got an 85.6 and a half inch television. I've got 3,000 watts of sound. I've got a $2,200 sofa, and I got
a 2-year-old.
And I got two black labs that love to sit on each side of me while I watch my movies. I am a movie theater.
But I've got a 2-year-old, and what she wants to watch is what I normally watch.
You adopted a 2-year-old from a piece of shit guy who wouldn't take care of him. You didn't go out and actually make one like I did with you.
No, well, I love her more than I would if I had.
Allegedly.
I love her more than I would have if I had. So. Strawberry Shortcake today, so.
Timmy John might be your real dad. That would explain the difference in brain level activity.
My ears are so low by comparison.
The very little he got to the extreme amount that you have. I have just enough to get through. I'm all right. I'm okay. Timmy John ain't got enough to wipe his ass, and you have too much to wipe your ass.
I was blessed with this beautiful thing called autism that has made me almost incapable of doing anything.
Get a check, son. Get a check.
It is a double-edged sword, I tell you. All right, next question.
My brother's a Republican Christian, by the way, if it tells you what we think of him.
Tim's a Christian. I didn't even know that he'd ever read the Bible.
I don't know that he has, but he's heard other people that have, and that's good enough for him. And I think he saw the movie The Ten Commandments, and he also saw a great movie that details religion quite accurately, and that would be The History of the World, Part 1.
I was going to say, I believe Mel Brooks is going to come into this somehow. I give you these 15.
Well,
these 10. 10 commandments.
Lead you to believe we might be missing 5 commandments, and I just wonder still to this day what they were.
Oh, I'm sure the driving automatic transmissions, front wheel drive.
Prince, have we told Dickon about the brand new 2003 Lincoln Town car that the Bolins now possess?
It is a very nice car. That is the last body-on-frame rear-wheel drive V8 ever produced in the United States of America.
Has the Mustang engine, I believe?
Yes, it's a 4.6 single overhead cam modular out of a Mustang. Very, very smooth power. Very, very, very good car. Needs a 6-speed, but...
Black with lots of silver trim, a beautiful grille, and functioning left and right turn indicators in my car.
Very nice.
How about your wipers?
The wipers are an issue right now. We have a bit of an issue with the wipers, but that'll be resolved Thursday.
I am actually looking for a Ford Torino at the moment.
Oh, by the way, I am installing a multi-$1,000 DVD navigational high-definition TV system into the doubled-in dash unit of the car. You can watch high-definition television at speeds up to 68.5 miles an hour. And we're looking very forward to that, to where we can watch Fox News at 68 miles an hour.
Nobody can afford watching Fox.
Don't go 69, because if you go 69, you probably won't see the TV.
Very nice. As far as the movies and stuff go, I've also caught Thor.
I also possess Thor. Sounds like I got a bootlegging industry going on over here.
Hell, no wonder Cornette calls you bootleg bowling.
Yeah, don't open. You can look at my left and right turn indicator, but God, please don't open the trunk of my car.
Oh, jeez.
I tell you what, the bootleg movie industry puts a Prince through college, is all I'll tell you. Prince, where'd you go?
All right, what else you got?
Prince, where'd you go to college?
We'll talk about that another day. What else you got?
All right.
Well, I mean, there hasn't been a whole lot that's really happened besides...
Well, we got kids being slaughtered in Norway. We've got CM Punk. We got Maurice, who doesn't know how to fucking hang up on somebody. We've got, let's see, looks like Beth Phoenix is getting back into the thick of things a little bit. Mark Henry getting a touch of a push. My old buddy.
Thank God, it's so long overdue for Mark.
Yeah, and this is what they should have been doing with him all along, and then you put him out there as a fucking badass, because ain't nobody going to fucking whip Mark. And if there is, it's a fucking handful, and that's because he's a nice guy and you got him laughing. If you get him mad, ain't nobody going to whip Mark fucking Henry.
I'd probably say the toughest guy in the company right now is probably Del Rio, and I don't think Del Rio's really got much of a shot against him.
Del Rio, from what you tell me, is a tough hombre, but you give me Del Rio mad and Henry mad, and I don't like Del Rio's chances unless he gets that fucking armbar on Henry. And even
I don't like an armbar on him. I feel like Henry's going to do much good.
Well, that's what I was thinking, because that still leaves another arm free.
And when you're in an armbar, you're not moving.
And you are not going to hurt Henry's legs.
No, not even a little bit.
Yeah, there's not a thing you're going to do. Now, Henry's a fucking legit bad hombre, and it's about time they treating him as such. Instead of having him out there with MVP doing fucking clown work.
And MVP, I mean, is another just dropped ball from hell. Yeah, but it's sad.
No one mentioned him, and I would put him above Lesnar and Batista as far as the
blown. I mean, you and I have been saying for years an MVP could have been the next Rock.
Could have been. He'd have been close. He would have been close.
The man was just good. He knew his psychology. He knew what he was doing. And he could recover shit. I mean, that's one thing that isn't really valued, but that match with him and Jericho, where they blew that spot and recovered it so well, I mean, you have to look at that kind of stuff. Like, who you can carry, how well you can carry somebody, how well you can recover from a blown spot. And those are two things that aren't valued as much as I think they should be these days.
Good point.
Yep. Well, I haven't.
You can tell when this show's going south when the hoe's going yip yip or do.
All right. Well, I'm going to go off in search of some food. You guys can enjoy the tail end of the show. All right.
Sounds good, Prince. We'll catch you next time.
I'll feed you another day, Prince. I'll feed you for free.
All right. Bye.
I said good day. It's a beautiful-